which I'm really excited about. Concurrency in general, one of my biggest passion, and I will try to go through a lot of material that you're able to download and talk, so I'm taking on with you and play with, for more familiar. So this is the agenda. We're going to go through the beginning briefly about some terminology. There are some confusion about some terminology we'll go through there. Event, parallel programming, asynchronous, and the after model where really F-sharp can shine. During the presentation, I have a lot of sample code that probably I won't be able to go through all code, but I will try also to show how you're going to interpolate with other languages, like, you know, call F-sharp from the C-sharp side, so be useful to integrate maybe some library you want to build with F-sharp. Before to start, anybody speeding with the concurrency in general, besides F-sharp, maybe other languages? Okay, cool. And F-sharp or in general?
C-sharp,
of course. All right, so concurrency. So why you want to build some concurrent application? Well, of course, because you want to be fast. You want to build some fast application. But we're living in a multi-core era. So all the devices we have two or more cores. Even probably the smartphone you carry in your pocket right now have two cores. And the vendor has reached the point that cannot build any faster single core. But what can provide is a system with multiple core. And I believe that being a developer is our responsibility to develop high performance and scalable application. And so, and leverage these multi-core systems. And more we have applications that deal with more data. And so we have a Mongo's data set to deal with, and our applications start, they need to talk with the service out there in the network, so we deal with, you know, networking, bandwidth, low latency, so it's kind of messy. So we need to deal with this issue and try to make our application performance as we can. So again, we have to deal with, you know, service side. You want to try to build application that leverage multi-core system to keep alive the server or the computation servers to be more responsive, and provide to the customer nice and friendly user experience. So you want to, you know, use the fact be fast and responsive. So terminology. So that's actually a little bit of confusion, but like we have the concurrent that when we have different computations that run in different threads. Versus parallel, we have a computation that runs simultaneously. So it's a bit different between the two. Like for instance, you cannot run a parallel computation in a single core machine, right? Because only one thread can run at a time. So you're kind of, it's not really parallel, you're only concurrent. And that's where, you know, people become confused, think concurrent mean parallel, vice versa. They're two different animals. Then we have asynchronous that we're gonna see later on, where we deal with, you know, pretty much IO operation when you call, you know, web services, file system, read and write. And can you see it right? I mean, okay, my screen is blinking here. All right. And then we have the event and the reactive, where, you know, you're gonna react some event in an in application. Here I just put just an idea where, you know, the different technology you can use depends on what you have to do. Like concurrent, you can use, you know, the agent or the React extension, we're gonna see later on. For the parallel programming, we're gonna through the TPL and threading. I'm not gonna spend too much time there because, you know, the TPL is something that can be used in other languages, but I want to really focus in something more specific of the language in F-sharp. Then the asynchronous, as I said, we're gonna use the computation expression in F-sharp for IO operation. And then the reactive, which is very nice, and the event and use this feature called combinators that is very interesting. And the Dirac extension actually is something that already built, partially already built in the F-sharp framework. I know if you want to use a Dirac extension like C-sharp, you download different library. So instead, there is partially already built in, which is pretty neat. So, and building concurrent application, there are some issues that you deal with. Like we deal with operations that they are non-deterministic. So we know when they start, but we don't know when they're gonna end it. And this creates some issues debugging, testing, and the synchronization between the threads can be tricky. So you start to lose some locking that can deal with end with some deadlocking, and your application start to be responsive. It's just not easy to program. So that's where F-sharp and functional programming in general can help you out. There are some features that they are building in functional programming that, for the nature of these, for the nature of the functional programming, can help you out better in multi-thread application. And first here is immutability. So first of all, who can tell me the difference between a thread and a process? Kim?
So typically, so when you spawn the two separate processes, they don't have shared memory.
Yep.
So when you'd have to do some sort of like inter-process communication or to do the shared memory, whereas if you spawn this separate threads within the process, those actually have to share state, so it's easier.
Yeah.
That's the main way you're doing.
Yes, that's correct. In fact, the problem with that, when you spawn multiple threads in the same process, that you share the memory, you share the same heap, right? So, and that way it possibly creates some corruption in the memory. Mm-hmm. And two threads can try to read or write at the same time the same memory location, and that's where it can create some issue. Instead, when you're immutable, well, it's immutable, so thread cannot change the state of the memory location.
I was going to say, that seems to be the hallmark of F-sharp.
Right.
Because of that this concept of what, passing functions and...
And that's, but in general, is a functional programming approach, right? So a different kind of mindset, but definitely can create tremendous benefits in a multi-thread application, right? And like the side effect free function, you have the function that don't have access to, I operation or create, side effect like printing a console and so on. So, well, here briefly, what is immutable, that pretty much in F-sharp, there is no concept of variable, it's all values. So when a value is assigned, it cannot change. And F-sharp is immutable by default. It can be changed if you want to. I don't recommend it, but And benefit is that, immutability is side effect free. So who knows what happened in the first NIP code? This, the first NIP is a C-sharp. And we create a collection function. So anybody try to guess?
You get 5 copies of the number 10 printed out to the console.
Right, that's correct, yep. And that's a different because being immutable F-sharp, in the second snippet of code, when you run, the value allocated in different memory. So the first NIP instead, you're gonna have like 5 × 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, and the second snippet code actually, thanks to the immutability, you're gonna have what you're expecting for, so 0, 2, 4, 5, so on. So that's actually pretty interesting. And so as I said, closure immutability is not really, is a good merit. So let's start to talk about events here. So events in F-sharp are a bit different than in C sharp or other .NET languages, they are considered, they are treated as a values. So we can get an event and be passed through a function as a value. So, and the benefit is that we can compose event, and from the event we can create different event, with a function that can, you know, capture an event or return a different event, and we can treat event really as a collection, thanks to the combinators. So this is the benefit of functional programming when you approach a programming style that is more declarative versus you know, the imperative language. So you program against what you want to do versus how. As you can see, I just compared the first simple code on your left. It's just a bad combination. I should use observable, but we're going to see later on that probably you can think that is a event.map, event.filter. And that's what F-sharp can provide out of the box, this possibility to combine event to create new event. And you're right, you can see the same sort of kind of example by using sequences. So it's like a collection. So you can reprogram event as an event stream as a collection. So a few slides more about the API, and then we're going to deep in some example here in code. So event map, you know, you just capture an event and map and return a different event. And the filter, if you want to just react of some sort of event, and just according to your predicate. The add, it just you register your handler. So that's going to be your reaction. Merge, when you merge different event to create a final one. Scan is interesting because you can, like for instance, we're going to see an example here. Let's say that you want to have like a mouse down and keep track of the line that you write. You're going to create probably an external variable to keep track of the state and so on. Instead, scan, you're going to be able to keep the state inside of the collection of value passed to the events. And events are observable. So actually, event is, I don't know if you see before, but event actually, that is from the interface iEvent, and iEvent are from observable. So really, you can use event or observable either way. There are two primary differences between the two. One is memory leak. Like, for instance, you have a bunch of event, and you register your combinator, and when you register, actually, it's just going to register the last event, and all the previous are still in memory. Versus the observable, have this extra API that subscribe or return a disposable. And in cascade, actually, hierarchically, you're going to unregister all the events that are part of the combinators. And the event scan, actually, is a little bit different because the observable create a new state for each handler. So it's really, it's a bit harder to keep the state of the events. And to use the event, you can combine the event, create new event, and be exposed to the other .NET languages, but only through the event, not to the observable. And I think it's very neat that it's already built in a F-sharp framework, this part of the, they call it reactive. And as you can see, pretty much the same API, the event, filter, map, add, merge, plus the last one that I put in bold, the subscribe, and the one that is very important to dispose and register all the event part of the combination. And here, just a quick example of how you can expose event to other .NET languages. Just create your event and decorate the event with the attribute CLI event. And C Sharp is happy, you can talk with. one another important feature, and then the next slide, I mean the next really, we're going to check some code, I promise, is we can leverage the asynchronous workflow and creates a very responsive UI waiting for the event asynchronously. So, like for instance, I know it seems like why one event, when I wait for an event asynchronously, but let's say that I have an example that probably every time I'm going to go through. Let's say that you have a click button and inside a for loop because you want to keep some state, and every time you click, the state change, right? Well, you can just, as I put this snippet code here, just wait asynchronously inside the for loop, and that's it. Every time you click, it's going to fire and trigger the event, and you can react accordingly without freezing the UI. All right, demo time. For now, any question? Let's see if I... All right, so event, I'll just make a list of the code I want to check with you first because I have a bunch of them. And again, all this code is going to be on GitHub, downloaded, play with, that are actually, I think I put together a good material to get familiar with all the possible features. So, shift, alt, return, right? Yep, okay. So, okay, I get this example here where I create the event here, selected, in a bit more traditional way, just to, I want to show different kind of angle how you can create the event. I just create, you know, like you're going to use, we're going to deal with our regular C-sharp language, create our delegate, and create our event. So I'm going to create my selector type here, which is a slider, and actually, you know what? Change my mind. Let's start first with run the application, and then see the code. Probably it's better to see actually what we're looking for, right? It's different. So, all right, so everybody can see this?
Mm-hmm.
All right, so this is a tree slider and a click me, so I guess you know what it does. So what I do is just, you know, change my slider here and automatically it change the color or my panel there, and when I click, it's just going to give me the value of my RGB. So I'm going to change. So pretty simple, right? So what I did, I just, you know, passing my type from the WinForm application, my tree slider control, and I register for each slider my event value change, and I map with my my type, right? You see here. I create my color update here. And then I create my combinator. And what I do, I just merge my three events. So I create one event, and I'm gonna keep the state of the color. And the reason we're gonna keep the state, so I can extract the value when I click the button. And I'm going to update my value and update my canvas. I just map the three colors that result from the merge events. And here I expose to my WinForm, the C-sharp application, my event and publish it. That's it. So let's see if I use the WPF application. And what I did here, I don't know if anybody familiar with the WPF and pattern view model, but what I did is just expose my event in a property called current color, and when the property changed in my F-sharp application, update my UI. So this was an example about events. Then mouse move. And just run. And I really like the wrapper in F sharp, right? So you can just run your code, Alt Enter.
That's cool. I didn't know about the if interactive thing.
Here?
No, the.
Oh yeah, like if you have a like FS file, which is, you know, no script, whatever script, you can run the two in the same way, but it will be tricky. Mm-hmm. So even interactive, actually, you can run it as a script. So here, what I did, just create my canvas. Okay. This is the OPF window. All right. So the letter just follow my mouse, okay? And they stop when they pass the 250, which is the half size of the waveform. All right? So how that's possible? Well, so what they did here, you know, I just create my UI here, so it's not really any fancy here. But I register my mouse move event, and I map it, and I change it with getting the position, the current position of my mouse, and I filter. So what I do is that until the first 300, you know, axis, the letter gonna follow my mouse, otherwise not. It's just this for the sake of the presentation to show that actually you can filter event and react accordingly. Then I add my handler, which is I use an asynchronous here to be more responsive, don't freeze the UI. So every time that you move the mouse, the letters start to follow your mouse asynchronously. And I put a build delay here, just, you know, to have more effect. And the start immediate here, you're going to see later on in an asynchronous workflow part, is the way you want to start a thread when you deal with the UI. So actually going to start in the current UI thread. And so of course we're awesome. All right, so I put this one here. Oh yeah, this is I want to deal with this one last, just to show one little thing, and then we're gonna move on. So here what I do, just a simple draw application. Okay, so see, so when I click my mouse and I move my mouse, I can draw. I pass alpha, I'm gonna change the color. Okay. Now when I click on transcribe here, I'm gonna dispose all my handler that I registered, so all my vendor just disappeared. So I click and subscribe, and now just trust me, I press my mouse. <It's not. laughs> So, and again, here with it to the code, I just want to show the nice feature about, you know, how easy is to register all the events in one click. All right, so that's what I have for the events before pass to the threading. Any question?
Exactly. When you have the async block,
yeah,
you're passing the async block to async start media.
Yeah.
What exactly was that doing? Okay. I understand conceptually, but like, how does that?
Does that create a function, and then like, how could you describe how what?
Yeah. So let's go. All right. All right, so we're talking about this simple code here, right?
Yeah.
So what they do here, the registration happens only once, okay? So It's not that every time they move my mouse, it creates a new asynchronous processing. This is only one block, and it's only one thread run. So I just register this block of is a synchronous block. And what happens that when I change my when I move my mouse, there is a chain reaction, the event, the map, the filter, and then it's gonna trigger, and the parameter here, which is just my point, it's gonna pass through this function that it continues running, right? As you can see, it is a loop, right? So for each character, part of my phrase here, you see, user capital is awesome. It just change the coordinate that they are in my waveform. So it's just one asynchronous operation, and at the start immediately, as I mentioned, I should put here one note here, is used when we run in a UI environment with like WinForm or the OPI form. So, you cannot update the control from threads that are not below. Okay. So the start immediate actually deal with this issue and for you update the UI without casting and, call the delegate invoke and so on.
So was it a better choice then? It says it's a better choice, but was it a better choice over? Is there another choice that would be bad?
Oh, no. This is a better choice. Like the traditional one, it should be like...
What is the traditional one, I guess?
Well, the traditional one should be in a WinForm. You're going to... each control has the possibility to check if it's invoked from the current thread or not. If it's not, you're going to cast it to a delegate that is going to come back from the current thread, right?
So start immediate is specifically for invoking on the UI thread.
Right. That's it's going to capture the synchronization context, the daemon context, and for you, it just cast to the right thread.
Okay. And can you also explain, I think you were saying that the async keyword is creating a new function body that is done once, like it's done during the assignment of observable.add, and what are we adding? We're adding a function p that has this new augmented body,
so,
and that happens once.
That's correct.
Okay.
This computation, but you register only once, right?
Right.
It's happened that here we are dealing with an event stream, right? So we have an event that coming from my mouse. So we have a series or sequence of events that keep coming. It's like, that's why I use the observable. It's like all the concept behind direct extension to deal with those big stream of events. So I register my event only once, which is inside this block here, right? So I register only once. It is a synchronous operation. It's running only one in loop inside. I don't know if that's gonna...
So I guess the question is like, what does the async keyword do?
What it does is just, as I mentioned earlier, wait asynchronously of the event coming, right? So, and here we deal with changing the and updating the UI because we change the coordinate of each letter, right? So you want to do it asynchronously. Otherwise, should be one, should be very slow and freezing the UI. Because, for instance, now I'm moving my mouse and only one mouse, but theoretically you can move your mouse and the letters for your mouse, but you can, move all the windows, close it, maximize, minimize, and so on. So it can be very responsive. At the same time, can be other update in a UI beside the mouse, right? So you want to be asynchronous to allow the UI to be refreshed without freezing.
But probably behind it, because I'm assuming this has the async.star median, and you mentioned the thread, probably spins up a separate thread to run the...
Yeah.
I think that was what I was not sure about.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
Well, I guess to help me out a little bit, the 90 is sleeping for 90, milliseconds?
Yeah, that's correct. And then I put that just to give some delay when you move your mouse, just to have a better...
Well, I guess what I'm saying, I guess I'd get more of a mental picture if, what if it was 900?
Well,
that's obviously close to a second, so then you get...
Let's try to remove first, okay?
Yeah. Yeah.
See if it's run all in one block. All right. You see?
There is no,
because the letter is so fast to be updated that there is no, right? And that's without delay.
Is it 90 seconds until it starts moving, or is it 90 seconds between each letter?
Between each letter, because it's a loop. You see, here I there is the loop that go through.
Is it loop?
Yeah.
The
characters.
Yeah. Each character. So for each character, I'm gonna change the coordinate. So I'm able to put, you know, one beside the other one, and with a build delay.
Cool.
And we're registering that for loop happens once for each time that the mouse moves.
Yeah.
This
in cascade run every time there is an event. So every time they move my mouse, this is happening.
And so we get a new async thread.
No, it's the same thread. These happen only once. They add up only once. And that asynchronous is waiting for events to come in, the pipe. Okay?
Where is the waiting happening on that remote thread? You know, inside the async thread?
Well, is that... Well, what's happening, okay. When I move my mouse, the event go through this chain here, mm-hmm. and here the P become my event argument. And every time I move my mouse, here my event, part of the event stream, is going to go through this asynchronous block here. And this is run only once. This is a registration, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the event is registered only once.
So
there's only one thread, but it's always waiting.
Yeah, so that thread is now waiting to handle
right.
What is happening. Okay. So when you move your mouse, you get an event.
Right.
It goes to that thread that's handling it. So then it goes through, then the loop. Then this handler runs in the async block and
right.
then moves
right.
ahead.
And is the start immediate? It's the start immediate is the return value, which is the body of fun P, right?
Right.
So the start immediate is all of that async block is getting fed into start immediate.
Right.
Start immediate is returning a value that is the body of the fun P, and that's what's getting registered.
Right.
Okay.
That's correct.
And the start immediate gives you that ability to have the event pipe from
right.
one thread into the other one, so that it can
yeah.
work, so that it can handle the.
Yeah, that's correct. That's
do
correct.
We really start the thread when we register or when the event happens? Because if, for example, we have 1,000 events, 1,000 handlers that mm-hmm. I want to register, and it will be only like 5 or 10 events that will happen in 1 hour.
So you're saying that if you have like 1,000 handler, you want to spend 1,000 of threads, is that correct?
Yeah, that's why I doubt that we start thread immediately. I mean, when the event happens, we start the thread or operating system find the thread.
Right. Now, one thing to say is that the asynchronous in F sharp in the back
mm-hmm.
use the thread pool, right? So even if you spend 100, 1,000 of asynchronous start immediate, in
yeah.
reality, you deal with few threads part of the pool, right? So, and we're going to see later when we're going to talk about the parallel that it's not really good practice start new threads. But start immediate actually is part of this thread pool. That so you deal only with a few threads at a time. And they deal in the back.
I know that in C sharp, yeah, that when you say async,
mm-hmm.
it's not guaranteed that it will be a new thread. If this current thread is free,
mm-hmm.
operating system will, okay,
yeah.
run here.
Yes, that. Like one of the downside about the synchronous is
mm-hmm.
that you're not really in control.
Yes.
And actually, that's part of my slide in the hand when you're gonna see the downside of asynchronous.
When you don't care about
right.
you just need
right.
not to freeze something.
Right. Like for instance, thread are bad, but if you really have to deal with long operation,
mm-hmm.
you want to spend a new thread. There's no doubt from that. There's no big deal.
Are you limited by how many async start thread or start immediates you can, or I guess that happens on the...
Well, the start immediate actually, you can have as much as you want to. Anyways, they're going to be merged together to the current thread, current the current synchronization context.
Yeah. So with that, if you commented out your thread sleep, which did that, which is an asynchronous continuation, right?
Right.
But you commented that there's no more asynchronous. There's
right.
no more break. So where does if we've got more than one, if we've got that loop running on the UI thread all the time, waiting for, I guess it doesn't. It runs through its full loop, and then it's done.
Right.
And then it frees up that thread to do whatever's
right.
next.
Right.
Okay. All right. Thanks.
So threading, I'm gonna go quick here because there is not really any magic in threading. Oh, no surprise. Well, all right, so Kim explained very well what is the difference between a thread and a process. So we're not going to go through that, but thread, you know, is the smaller unit in processing of the operation system. And as we mentioned before, thread share memory heap, so it can be dangerous, especially in, when you build multi-thread application. And in the last line here, I put that each thread on the own stack, so they own some memory. So every time that you spend a new thread, there is some memory that some memory pressure. So is 1 megabyte is not bad, but think about it. You know, if a 32-bit operation system, which is like 2 gig or 3 gig, I think 2 gig of so when you have like, I was watching this video that actually you can span until I think 1200 thread before that you have like memory crash. And you think 1200 is a lot. Yeah, but even if you open your task manager and see how many threads you're running, especially Outlook, even Notepad, you're gonna be crazy. Like we do nothing, I think it was like 16 to 20 threads running in Notepad. So, but thread can be evil. So just be aware about that. So as I mentioned, you know, the thread and spanning multiple thread in a single CPU machine is not really parallel, it's concurrent, right? And if you have too many running simultaneously, you can create actually run make your application run slower because you have this overhead is to the switching context, right? And we can run some issue like, you know, possible race condition when actually a nice demo we're gonna see later when two threads try to read and write the same time, the same variable, what damage can create. And if you try to fix the problem, well, you can have some deadlocks, which are very bad for the application. And the thread are also hard to manage, like it's not recommended to the thread abort to stop your thread, and that's because there are some issue. It creates an exception back and can leave your share state corrupted. And if you run some asynchronous operation, it can leave your operation still running anyways. And anyways, if you try to synchronize between the thread, can be very hard to program to the synchronization to the primitive type like mutex and semaphore and so on. So one issue we have is thread condition, as I mentioned. And here we have actually, this is snippet code here, but I'm almost done with the slides about threading. And we actually is a demo here that is very interesting. And well, as I just mentioned, if you try to fix it, you have some bad deadlock there, right? So the thread in F-sharp is F-sharp provide out of the box a little bit an easy way to approach the threading programming because the natural, the functional programming built in a language. We have, as you see here in the bottom of the slide, three different simple code that do exactly the same thing. One is imperative way, which have the classic, change the state of variable to the loop, versus the declarative way we are forced to use in this way because the immutable, the immutability built in on the F sharp. And again, parallel, it just, you know, change to sequence to P sequence. It just use the P link in the back. And the thread is fully integrated in the .NET. That's why I won't waste so much time here. Is use exactly the same library, TPL library, in .NET and P-Link. You can abstract the library in F sharp to make it a bit more user friendly, but use the same exactly API and thread pool and so on. So let's check a few things about threading here. I guess there's more in here. Hmm. Well.
It's okay.
Hold on, what was it?
You mean you don't program like this?
Sorry. Usually I do. Come on.
It's very convenient.
Yeah, yeah. 80 characters is too much. We're thinking 10 characters.
Oh boy. Come on. Alright, so. Alright, you know what? I'm just gonna close it. Maybe open it. Yeah, let's hope they're gonna work.
Really?
Alright. Hopefully it's gonna work. So, any questions about the threading? I try to go fast about the threading because it is now. I think that you can find documentation about TPL, you know, shared with C sharp, so it's not really where F sharp shine there. And I'll spend some time more interesting thing. But so threading, I have just the basic that I'm gonna go through briefly. And the race condition is interesting. So briefly here, as you can see, I use the same API in the other .NET languages. I create my thread. I can spawn thread here. Actually, it's pretty cool. I put here that, you know, there's a shadowing function. You can use the same thread name in a function that shadow the other value with the same name. Thread pool here, you know, classic. You just right here. We have a thread pool. Not anything that I want to show you, waste too much time. I want to go instead to race condition that is a nice example. So, all right. So here I have two functions, one called semarray and one the lock semarray. So as you can see, see we have two thread pool here, two thread that they have a for loop inside, and then at the same time they update the same value, the total. And so there is some race condition because it can happen that at the same time the thread, the two thread can access the same variable. So let's run this to the. So, okay. So I create my array here, and this is a million array, so the sum should be a million, right? So if I use my sum array where the two thread try to sum the same time, I don't know if you can see.
Yeah, half.
Yeah. If I run it again, I will get a different value because that's the problem with this condition. My locked sum array function is not the same functionality, but as you can see here, I just use a lock. So a thread can access the variable only one at a time. So I have a million here. Yeah. All right. I think that was pretty cool to show, actually, because sometimes you talk about race condition, but it's hard to reproduce the JS condition time, right? All right.
What about lock-free algorithm and lock-free data structures in F sharp?
Talking about, well, lock-free, can you be more specific?
I was reading recently, in Java, they discuss a lock-free algorithm. They have locking, but they don't have race condition there. They don't lock resource, and they don't have deadlocks, not race condition. They don't have deadlock, they don't have race condition, but they lock-free. They don't have lock.
Yeah. I was reading actually how they Microsoft built the concurrent collection,
mm-hmm.
familiar, and they actually the concurrent bag and the concurrent bag, I think it was one of the two, they actually used this kind of algorithm. I don't know if actually if you use a reflector you can see how they works in the back, but yeah, that's definitely a solution. I mean. What I recommend usually when you have to update a variable or use the built-in interlock.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not familiar with that. Yeah, that's probably the faster way. And I have other example, but I really don't want to waste too much time there. Again, the code you can be downloaded and check. Just for the sake here, you see, I can use all the task parallel library from .NET in F sharp without any issue. And there is some example you're gonna see here how you can run task and event in the code you can download from GitHub, so you can go through there and play with. But again, it's nothing really super special. So, but let's go to start the interesting stuff here. It's about time, right? All right. Asynchronous workflow in F sharp. So, asynchronous operation is used usually when we have an input outbound operation, so when we talk with database, remote service, or file system, and is a non-deterministic computation, so we know when it's run, when it starts, we don't know when it is back. And so it's hard to debug, and usually is hard to manage exception and cancellation, we're gonna see shortly. Traditionally, we're gonna write our code in sequential style, right? I don't know if anybody experienced to build asynchronous operation in classic .NET, so but you have to deal with the begin pattern, end pattern, and these two things are decoupled. So when you're gonna wrap your exception, where your transaction start, when you're gonna, so it kind of messy, right? And also combine different operations. I say, okay, I'm gonna read asynchronously, and when I receive my callback, I'm gonna write. So the code start being noise and very long. So what we say, we're going to give up and say, forget it. We're going to just write our classic synchronous operation. Like this example here, going to call my data from the remotely service. But the problem here that no scale, if you run in a UI thread, your UI going to freeze eventually. So it's going to create a bad user experience. And so to solve the problem about the nice user experience, so we're gonna do, you can write a synchronous, use the synchronous model. Here, actually I use the event model, yeah. Anyway, so here you can see in the slide, you register your event, you call back when the operation complete, and you start your operation. And again, as I mentioned, this is it's possible. There is a some downside, as I mentioned, because to deal with the transaction. Actually, I discovered last week that in 4.5 framework, there is a new option in transaction scope that actually deal with the asynchronous correlation. It's like async flow option. So something that I actually probably didn't realize that they need to implement in the framework. Here another example of an APM pattern. As you can see in red, we create our callback. And then the last line here, we create, you know, our, we register our callback and deal. So what's the problem here? So what about an exception? Where are we going to put it? And then how many times you have start the single operation, but you have to pass some state in a callback, right? Because you want to deal with some object in a callback. So here I put null, but sometimes you put your object here in a callback, you're going to retrieve, you're going to cast it, you have to check. So it's just a lot of work. So F-sharp is awesome. It's just out of the box, give you an easy way and to implement a synchronous workflow and deal with all the issue with the, that you have your traditional approach. So inside this nip here, you have the async. The difference is in red. So you just put your async in your block. You're going to use your let with the exclamation point and call it bank, which I'm going to explain in the next slide or two what actually does in the back. It's just synthetic sugar for, you know, continue monadic expression, right? Is that right? That's expert.
I think so.
All right. I know you're expert, but and what is great here is that it's all right in the same block, so I can wrap it in a try catch, right? Or I can wrap in a transaction scope and just work without probably all different kind of scope. Here the same file stream read that there was before, just converted in. So you see it's a way less noisy. It's a deal with our more traditional way to write the code synchronously, like step by step, right? But it's asynchronous. And let's say if I formulate right, the flow stop, but the current thread doesn't, right? So where is the let bang in red there? Then my flow stop and wait into the callback because I registered my callback there. But the current thread is still running in the back. So responsive UI and in scalable. I can span this operation in parallel. As you can see here, the last line here, I can wrap it all my operation in a collection. And I use the async parallel in F sharp. And automatically, you're going to just run it for you in parallel, and to deal with any extra code. So here is I put this slide just to curiosity to know what the let bang does for you. It just, as you can see here, it continues to pass the computation. So if you have the async delay, you have a function that bind to our read asynchronous function. Bagina is the name of my dog, by the way, just if you ask. And then when it's done here, it continues with the next async binding with the write. So it just a continue passing the operation. So pretty much it does what you do in the traditional asynchronous approach, but it make it nicer for you, make it easier, right? So just a few things here. As you can see, you can deal with the catch. So there are two ways to deal with the catch in asynchronous. So one is wrap your computation in a try catch block, or you can let F sharp to deal with you. So you can see here, the second line, you have the pipeline async catch. And if something happened for you, is an exception that you know deal with, you're going to catch it for you. And the return of the computation, instead to be the result you expect, you actually have two choice. One, the result, you're definitely, you know, gonna go without any issue, without exception. Or the second one, if there is an exception. At that point, you can deal with the error as you want. Cancellation here is a nice feature that is different from the classic C-sharp async new keyword. You are actually in control here to cancel the asynchronous computation. You just pass, you know, a token, and you have this token that you can cancel your computation, and you can even register an handler or not that it's gonna be fired if the computation will be canceled. So this is my favorite, and I just put the slide just because I just love it so much, I wanna share it with you. It's the start with continuation in F sharp. So this is pretty much all the functionality you desire in one spot. So you have the start with continuation, and you pass as first parameter your asynchronous computation. And then you have three functions, three callbacks that you can register. And one, when the result, when the computation complete with success. The second function is only when there is an exception. And the third one, when you cancel. So this is very useful. I found that in my when I work with F sharp and build a library that can communicate with C sharp, this is probably the one I use the most. Full integration with the task library, and so when you build your asynchronous workflow in F sharp, you can make a tool with C sharp or VB.NET. Any VB.NET developer here? Yeah, I wonder. They are very, you know, in extinction. But anyway, so you said the third line from the bottom there, the async create as a task. So you're gonna pass your computation as a task to C sharp and just deal as a task. So last slide about computation, about asynchronous here, is about the limitation that you have. Well, as speaking before, you're not really in control. You spawn asynchronous computation, but you're really in control to create affinity with a processor, or when you run in parallel, you're not really in control to know how many in parallel actually are working, right? It just everything deals for you in the back. So there is this losing control that, you know, can freak you out a little bit, but deal with. But there are better approaches you're going to see later. There is an approach that when we're going to talk about the actor model, that you're in full control about how many parallel asynchronous computation you can run. And let's demo something here. Any question about the synchronous? Let's see if I... All right. So for the synchronous, I have several snippet code here. I even have an example of the background worker that is a component built in .NET. I won't waste any time here, but just download the code, play with. Use a thread pool because it's a synchronous delegate, so that use a thread pool in the back, and you can. It's useful when you run in some sort of UI like WinForm.pf, because you have this nice event built in that you can update the UI during the progress of the computation or cancel it. But let's try. I want to code number 3. This one here. Okay. This is a. I'll enter. All right. So, as you can see here, it's easy to write your asynchronous computation. Run synchronously is like this thing that you say, yeah, awesome, but why? Right? Because why you want to run something asynchronously? Well, debugging. Usually you run something in debug, you want to, it's hard to debug, you know, when you have a multiple asynchronous computation running simultaneously. So, that's usable for debugging. That's my experience. Version 3 here. The number 5 is interesting. So here, when you write, you know, different computation and let F sharp run all the computation parallel for you. And here I put start as a task because in this way you can create your collection of a synchronous computation and pass it to F sharp, and F sharp can deal for you as a task. All right, so here I, oh, that's why I put 5. Okay, so here I have actually these three URL, which is meetup, dc, f sharp, I should do the same, anyways, and fsharp.org, okay? So, and actually I put sequential, so I want to just to go through with you and to show how easy it is to convert this sequential process in a synchronous, right? So firstly, we're going to change your imap. As we saw in the slide, we're going to change, you know, use a sync word and wrap all your computation in a sync, right? Now, the download string is not really asynchronous, so you're just going to use the asynchronous model here and put the let band here, as we saw in the slide, and that's it. Now you have a sequence here, so now we have a sequence, so we can just run in parallel, and for the sake here of the demo, we can use asynchronous, right? So that's it. So I just run it, and here I get my result here. So it took me, what, 20 seconds or even to go through and change it, so I think that I really believe that the Sharp can bring the next level of the developer skill to leverage what the framework can provide to create, you know, easily and almost bug free, high performance scalable application. So then what I have here, version 5. Primitive tag, no. Yeah, 7. I have the list of the code I want to see with you. But, so, let's see. Here, a quick cancellation demo. So I think, oh yeah, so here I'm going to create my task, okay, just a simple for loop, they're going to update my UI just, you know, with the sequence of 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on until finish. And there is a delay between each step of 1 second, so we have time to cancel it. Then I have my handler, and they're going to be triggered when the operation be canceled. So I start my computation. Actually here, well, I'm going to show you later a different approach, but I'm going to pass my task, my asynchronous computation, and my handler are going to fire when the computation is canceled. So we run a C update here, I just magically cancel. So I know, very impressive. Well, but it's very easy to implement, if you think about it. So that's the goal of the quick demonstration here. You generally have just a few lines of code to write, and think about if you had to build the same computation in C#, just madness. But here I want to just show you how you can create your API and expose in C#, okay? So with the same functionality to cancel the asynchronous computation. Like, if I don't know if you're familiar, but C#, probably you're familiar to mention the async keyword in C#, you just start the computation. But unless you're not going to start as a task, you're not really in control how to cancel. And not just that, but even you pass the task, how is canceled is not really cancel the computation, but is check if there is a, I think it's throw cancellation exception, something like that. I forget about it. But it's some weird noise code. So here just a five line of code, and you've wrapped this and pass it to C sharp, and actually this is gonna run for you in a single computation that you're gonna pass here. And here I use the object expression. That came, is correct?
Yeah.
Here is called object expression. But anyways, I'm gonna just pass a new implementation of that disposable. So what C sharp gonna see is that this method is gonna run a computation asynchronously that return a disposable and just dispose it. It's gonna cancel for you the a single computation. So pretty easy to implement. And then let's go to another demo. The other demo, there are a little bit of both photo viewer here. So let's start first the code. Oh yeah, I was getting this one. And then I'm gonna show the code here. So I have my WPF application here with three bottom up and the top. We have like download asynchronously, the agent asynchronously. Well, we know what's gonna happen with sync, right? We're gonna start to run, but we're gonna be freeze. That's all my dog pictures there. So very slow, one pitch at a time. And I think that I have a bug here, so I have to restart it, because otherwise it doesn't delete the pitch on the back. And now, asynchronously, instead, you can see it's faster, right? It's for you in parallel, you're gonna go up, actually, is going up on my own website right now and download this picture one at a time. So thanks to Beeline Network. So let's check the code briefly here. So we have the get image, and for back actually I also create through the file system here, but as you can see here, we have to load all the single operations. So what I do, as I showed before, just change your code, it's very simple. I'm gonna get all my asynchronous operation running parallel and start. So get image here, it's just gonna go out, go to my website, get a response here asynchronously, get the thread, start to read asynchronously, combine it, and copy the stream in my local file system asynchronously. That's all it does. I can show you right now the actor model, briefly the code, and I'm gonna go back to the slide and start the actor model. So let's run here the application again. So, as I mentioned before, when you run asynchronous in parallel, you're not really in control. You know, now the application is going to adjust in parallel all the asynchronous operation, and maybe one, two, depend, you know, the resources. If I download with the agent, actually, I am exactly in control how many asynchronous operations run simultaneously. Isn't that cute? this is my favorite. That was New Zealand. So Here is the actor model, and I probably won't make any sense, or maybe yes, I don't know, but we're gonna go through this code and slide a better example. But what I do here, I'm just gonna create this function first. That what it does, we're gonna create n number, you know, of agent. And for each agent, I'm gonna pass my function f. In the same time, I'm gonna return the one agent, which is like the master. And the master agent just waiting asynchronously to receive a message, which are all my URL, the passed to the pipe. And it distributes this URL in a loop here. This is probably a better way, but not for the sake of the presentation. They're gonna send the URL for a different agent part of my array. And this is the function that I pass through. So what I do here, this is a function that is running in each of the n agents that I spawn. And here I use 8, but one other thing you can do here is, of course, so let's say you want to run it for the number of the core or the process that I have in my machine, right? So I'm going to just do this, and it's going to be my one agent for each processor. And when I see the message, each processor just do the same thing that was doing with the asynchronous process, just get the image from my website. So we're going to go now through the actor model, and everything that you just saw now will make more sense. Actor model. And this is something that I'm very passionate. I mean, actor model is where probably F sharp really shine and make a big difference in all the .NET stack. Even so, the actor model, it comes from the Erlang style message passing, which is probably the first language that implement this model. And an actor is an independent computational. What does it mean? That is encapsulate the state, so the memory is isolated, so there is no it's thread safe. We're going to see now that the loop that ran, or I want to say the loop, that's wrong, but what's happening inside the actor is isolated from all the other actor or that part of my application. Usually when you build an actor, you have a queue, so the actor just waits asynchronously for a message to arrive, and then when the message arrives, just deal with it. But for other messages are incoming, they are buffered, so no message is lost. So that's how it looks, right? So we have our sequential model, our parallel model, with a kind of distributed up there, and the agent-based, which is a bit more messy. Now, for me, the actor model look more like this. You know what it is? I think probably some of you are familiar with it. This is a DC metro map. And I like to think as the train is our message passing between our train station that, receive the train, do something, or passenger go out, passenger go in.
Like you said, that it's reliable.
Yeah. So. Well, it's not deterministic, but the cool thing is that the train station in Chinatown don't know anything that happened at train station at Pentagon or other train stations. They are all independent, but they are connected. I think that makes more sense. But so the actor pretty cool because in a very high distributed system, an actor can be responsible to create new actor. And we're going to see in a demo later, there are some exceptions. There are some, you want to build application at full tolerance. So what's up with it? There are some exception agents. So there are some agents that can check that. And act accordingly, create a new agent or log or whatever. You can communicate between agent, and we saw in the example that I show now, I just send a message, but what about the reply? Maybe some agent send a message and wait for a message back. Well, there is a, I'm gonna see post and reply, but in other system you can just send a message with the address of the actor, right? Now, one downside of the actor mode in F-sharp versus the Erlang is that in F-sharp, all the actor run the same process. Versus Erlang, actually, they are different processes. Actually, each actor in Erlang is like the little operation system, so it's crazy. I don't know if anybody familiar with Erlang. I pray it would be with them.
Does that kind of run the risk of possible corruption if they're in the shared memory and the same process?
No, because thank you to us. That's a good question. So you can see my slide here to answer your question. Is that each actor has a private state, right? So you're not sharing any state.
Okay.
And because the state is immutable, now you can change the behavior, but it's like looking for trouble. Why bother, right? So I think in my, here, the actor just receive a message and react accordingly, and for each message can perform some computation and notify that actor. You have to think about actor like a web, like the metro map, that all connected and can talk each other. And well, we already saw how build an actor. So the last, the bottom of the slide probably is by random, but here I just want to share the difference between you can have mutable state or immutable state actor. So something that you want to avoid probably the left side, but it's possible. So you just create, in a loop, in a while through receive a message and update the state of the resize array collection there. And then you can expose also the collection. Or you can actually, we're going to see in the next slide, you can have functionality to update the state of my agent and then retry the state. So think about that you can build a super concurrent collection here, right? You can just your add and get your agent, and asynchronously you're gonna just react according with the message and deal with this this collection that you'll build inside the agent, which is isolated. And then we have more the classic more functional approach. We have the recursive loop there. So the first step that you want to do when you build your agent is create your message, right? So you want to create a static type message to build your actor, and you can use your matching pattern, and we're going to see later when you receive a message, detect what kind of a message you have and react accordingly. Here we have like the add operation, which is waiting for a string and a type T, which we don't know. A get, which we're gonna wait for a string, and is waiting for a sync reply that we're gonna see later. It's just a channel build that the message that the actor receive, you're gonna compute, do something, and then reply back to the sender or the caller, whatever. Where will they talk about this? So let's go on here.
I guess at my more elementary level, is this actor something you're creating with the existing code, or?
Yeah, no, it's the building. There is a, I'm gonna show the code. In F-sharp, you call actually mailbox processor.
It's
yeah, I already named it because I just think that the name doesn't make any sense. Like, It's like working in the post office.
Yeah.
But so the real name in F sharp is mailbox processor.
And I thought I saw that before in another one of your examples.
Yeah.
Is that fair that
I was wondering whether that was his own class.
No, that's
yeah.
What
well, I'm going to show you later what they do usually, and pretty much what I see also in the community, that the first thing everybody does is create an alias in the top and say, my mailbox process, I want to call agent, I want to call actor, I want to call whatever, just to change the name, because I just think that doesn't make any sense. So yeah, sorry about that. That's a good question. So here we have the our API. So we post asynchronous the message, post the wait. Now, post and reply, the wait synchronously. So actually, my UI is going to freeze waiting for the reply for the agent. But a better approach is the last from the bottom here, async reply. So where actually my UI is just waiting for a callback that receive asynchronously. And the try, which is the third and the last one, the try post and reply and post and try async reply, it just has built in a timeout, which is nice. You can say, hey, I'm going to wait for 10 seconds, but something happened, well, move on, do something else. We're going to check this is there is also the receive part of the actor model when it's waiting asynchronously for a message. And there's also the scan. Scan is something that it just changes the state internally of the actor. And so it's great to build, you know, like some sort of state machine in your actor. But what I put here, like the resum part here, the only example I didn't think actually I use it is when I use scan when you build an actor that can pause, resume, replay. So you change the state, and so you can say, I'm going to pause here, so my agent is going to start to be in a state that waiting for message can be only restart, for instance. Does it make any sense, the scan part?
Hmm.
A lot of thinking. And the last slide before demo is, again, usually a good practice to encapsulate your actor, so you can expose the actor to other languages like, you know, C-sharp and other language, I forgot what's the name. So usually just encapsulate it here. And when you have like the async get, the last, in C-sharp, you just go run as a task and just wait asynchronous for the callback, which is pretty neat. Demo time. So the actor, I have a few things here. And again, all the code can be downloaded, so you're gonna have the picture of my dog too. So agent. So let's go to the basic here. So here are you gonna build your agent, right? We saw it in the slide here. Here it was what we're talking about, line 6 here. So this is the mailbox process, the real name, the official name in F sharp. I just alias this name with something that I like better, like agent, can be actor. I think that everybody can agree with that. So, agent. Agent are super light.
I'm curious, at the top, where does agent come from? I mean, or mailbox? Threading,
yeah.
Is it threading?
Which one?
Collections?
This one?
No, but up further, doesn't it come from one of these?
This one?
No, next.
The,
is it from threading?
Yeah.
What that's called? It's all in threading, is it? Those are libraries?
It's in F.
Oh, no, actually, no, it's in F sharp, built in. It's part of the. You can.
Huh.
I can remove all the namespace here. It's still, my intelligence can tell me that mailbox.
Wow. Oh, okay. And then there's the.
It's a really part of the framework. That's something unique that. I think that in C sharp they try to mimic with data flow part of the external library, but it's not good as F sharp. So really part of the.
So thing. Actor, yeah, it's not
yes,
like something you cooked up here.
Right. No, no. I wish.
With tools, right? Yeah, it's.
And actually, as I mentioned before, mm-hmm. Erlang kind of, you know, is a can. Tow between processes. F sharp can. I tried to build my own, but then there was a library out there that you can use called Actor FX. Mm-hmm. And actually, you can really talk to different machines, to different agents. It's pretty crazy. Mm-hmm.
If you run in the same process, like the default way, does it have any isolation guarantees?
Yeah.
It does?
Yeah.
Like you mentioned earlier with the immutable state and the private state and stuff.
If you want it, you have really had to do it yourself. And like, you know, everything is the immutable as default, but you can change it. The isolation is guaranteed. You can change it. But you want it, is your foot, right?
And you can change, is it like a preprocessor directive that you have to change it, or is it just...
No, just your code, yeah. Yeah, you have these, like for instance, let's say that in a message you can pass, I don't know if it's correct, probably I'm wrong here, but
you had a slide on it, if you want to pull it up, but you had a slide with the immutable and non-immutable.
Yeah, let's see. So the mutable, the one you're talking about, is in on your left. Mm-hmm. Now think about, you can even pass a reference or collection. It's a mutable collection as a part of the message. And so the agent can change the state. I think that's probably, I'm not sure about that. I have to check that. But it's guaranteed. Like here, the nice thing that in your internal loop that run asynchronously here, you pass your state part of the loop here. The names is the state that continue passes in your.
But there's no, like, if I have two different agents,
right?
I can have like a shared in scope variable. They are a shared in scope value,
mm-hmm.
and they both of them could refer to that and potentially.
Yeah.
Mutate that. The compiler's not going to complain. It's just you're. By discipline, you're not going to do that because it's a bad idea.
Right, that's correct.
But it will let you.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. So.
But again, it's something, you know, it's a good practice. You want to avoid that.
Great. Right. Okay. But it's not enforced. Like,
No.
Okay.
Like, that's the thing about Erlang, because they are computing in two different processes.
There's no possible.
Right, there's no way, right? So I was saying here, agent or actor, whenever you want to call it, a super light. Here I have an example that actually I create 10,000 agent and just run it. You can see here. And now I just pass a message for each agent. And now I just hear in the code say that every time that the agent, you know, can be divided by 10,000 are going to print some data in the UI, so you can see here. But right now I have 100,000 agents running in the back. So, and pretty cool. I'm going to reset this. So there is no limit here. As say, now you know, use wisely, right? So the error agent here, I want to show. You can create an agent, actually can be responsible, one of my 10,000 agents, for instance, can be responsible to receive message to the other agent that they have an exception, right? Login, audit, whatever. And what they do here Here I can create like 10,000 agents, and for each I'm gonna register this error event. I'm gonna register my handler that is gonna send a message to my error agent responsible here. And the trade safety is guaranteed because the agent can only deal with one message at a time. So even all these my 10,000 agent throw an exception simultaneously go through the pipe, there's only one message go through at a time. So let's run this. Let's run all my 10,000 agent. And now I'm gonna run this loop for each agent and create for some of them some exception. And you can see all the agents that have 99 in a ID, you're gonna throw an exception. So pretty cool. And okay, here I just print in a UI, but you know better than me, you can do something more useful. Agent replies. Oh, I want to do this. This is nothing super fancy, but. Yep.
I'm somewhat familiar with GPUs,
mm-hmm.
which are, as you know, you're familiar, right? Massively parallel threading,
mm-hmm.
especially CUDA, right?
Right.
Don't ask me to write anything, but the concept. And so I'm trying to think, what are all our agents doing? I mean, it's kind of neat, but can they?
No.
What are they waiting for?
So I was working this presentation last weekend,
yeah.
And one of my goals, say, I'm gonna go through and maybe put some GPU in there. I didn't have time, so I put something that I'm gonna go through. And I've done some work in GPU. That's different animal, okay? There are some library that built in top in F-sharp, you can deal with CUDA from F-sharp, but.
Yeah, there's that fairly, is it Lou's book that talks about it, although it's unbelievably complicated.
Yeah.
His example, do you know the book I'm talking
yeah.
about?
But my example was more simple and was just, you know, create some Monte Carlo simulation with the GPU, something like that. But the difference is that, you know, we're talking about GPU that can have 64, 256 to almost probably a couple of thousand, I don't remember, but can run thread simultaneously.
Sure.
That's different. Here, the agent can be 100,000, but in reality, you can run computation simultaneously according to the name of the course of your machine. Even if you have 10,000 or 1,000 of agent, if you have an 8-core machine, it's going to be only 8 computation at a time. The other agent is going to deal with the message and the time, right?
Well, I'm looking for an example because it just doesn't. I don't know what 10,000 things are waiting for.
Well, that was an example to show.
No, it's a power. I agree.
Right.
I'm not Chris, but.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I guess you're doing that here.
There is blog post, I don't remember the author, but he was game developer in England, and he described that they have agent for each player session.
Right.
They capture the state,
uh-huh.
and player is playing, they can leave, they can just interrupt, they can do whatever they want, and each agent is dealing with player session. This means that you can have like 1,000 players.
Mm-hmm.
I doubt that each second they will interrupt. They are waiting. They put bet. They are waiting. But each agent can deal only with one player, and they guarantee that. They capture state and.
Yeah.
From one point, you have like in memory 1,000 agents, but from another, it's like okay, we have this. Player send some request.
So
the system knows which agent should process it, and after this
the process again, CUDA is all about threads, and which ultimately really do one computation at a time.
Right.
They try to be the same.
But
here your agent is more than a thread or less than a thread.
Less. as a size in memory, the footprint is small.
Yeah.
We talk about, you know, a few kilobytes. I think there was a post about that, but the good thing is that, as it was saying, it's all asynchronous. Like, there was another nice blog, they actually they built this real-time internal chat system, and for each, you know, user, for each chat, was spawned a new agent.
I'm sorry, for each what?
For each
chat user.
For each user.
Chat user, sure.
Yeah, yeah,
okay.
So someone in a chat room. Each
right.
Uh-huh.
Yeah,
room, so
that would see that,
and
yeah.
Because it doesn't use extra resource in the system, you can have the main as well. So your system can be, you know, very scaled. So here, type some test, ciao, and I'm gonna replay ciao. So super fancy demo.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But let's check the code. So here, I just built an agent actually gonna use the replay channel as we spoke. So here, my message is just a message that is a string and a channel that they're gonna return back a string, right? Hold on. Let's stop this one. So my agent here that I run is gonna wait asynchronous for my message that is part of two, in this case my string, which is this string here, and my replay channel, which is this part of the message here. So let me see the typing inference in F sharp. It's all amazed me.
Huh.
And so I don't do any computation here, but what I do is just grab my string and reply back to the sender, to the caller. That's the sender, yeah. And of course the console part is just, you know, read line.
So could this be a simulation of a metro? I'm thinking almost so many years ago when I learned about, I guess, a simulation language.
Mm-hmm. There are,
waiting.
Post in online, you can check. There is, you know, this carnivore behavior, ant colony kind of simulation.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing.
And this, using this, yeah, I was thinking this ability to have that many.
Yeah, I mean
interactions.
I think that, you know, all the concurrency programming model in F sharp really is brilliant, and all these actor models are just something that I fall in love with, really. Just great stuff.
Can you broadcast messages, or is it just you have to send as an agent? If you want to send to multiple people, you send to each of them?
Broadcast mean like one message to all the agent,
yeah.
Basically. Yeah, you can do that. It's just, you know, a better about your code. There is a, I can give you the link. There is this code. I don't know if it's in GitHub, but there is this kind of approach where there are a lot of agents waiting for the same message because each agent is going to deal with the same message in a different way. It was just a small broadcast, probably like three agents, I guess. But from there, you know, the level you can be as many as you want to. But yeah, I can give you the link about that.
So what's the term? Are you spawning agents, or are you... Maybe you said it, and I didn't.
Oh, here?
Yeah, what?
Well.
Creating them?
Yeah, here, well, you know, F sharp is kind of, it's not really poor lazy, but what's happening here, if I create a function here with agent and run my agent here,
right,
we're gonna.
That mailbox.
It's gonna be just spawned right away. If I put the parentheses here, it's not, it's waiting for me that they're gonna call the function later. So here I just don't use the parentheses in F sharp, and automatic agent is spawned right here.
But I see that word async again.
What is it?
Right. So.
Oh, don't look this code here, okay?
Pardon?
Don't look this code here. This one is from line 19 down. It's just console. Is it's just a matter of.
No, but right up there, let rec loop equal async.
Yeah, this is a loop. That is is the body of the agent, right? So the agent is spawned, and what it does inside just run this loop asynchronously, and his learn rule asynchronously stop here and is waiting asynchronously for the message to be received. This is an asynchronous operation. You see the type return async type message. So at that point is stop the flow.
The async transforms the block that you give it. It changes it somehow. And that becomes the new body. So that's what the async key is doing. But it's
yeah.
Well, it seems integral to this concept of an agent.
What do you mean?
I think you could write it.
You write it without async?
I think you can write it without the async keyword, but
uh-huh.
It's...
makes sense. It looks like they're building up these abstractions.
Well, you can't.
He actually gave
the example before where he had... it was much more nested.
Uh-huh.
It was it was downloading one picture of Baidu and then the other picture of dog, that JPEG.
Well, that's certainly...
Yeah, we can go back to that.
It's very illustrative, yeah. It's
just the longhand way of doing it, but the async keyword is letting you use the let bang and the do bang, which basically... it's saying when you get this answer, then whatever comes below this is what you should do next with that answer.
Right.
So it's a continuation passing style.
Right. And you think about the let bank as like register your callback here. This is the synchronous gonna be. It's running here, and this is your callback. When it's done, this is your callback here. And then you continue down. And here, part of the console, it just ran a current thread, so it stopped me, but I wait for my input here,
okay.
And I create my my asynchronous message, my post, and then I just run asynchronously here. I can do, something like this, but whenever you want to do it, right? So just run. All right, so let's see if I have are we going with time here? About 10 minutes I can wrap up everything. Then we're going to the raffle and then beer or probably hot cocoa, I don't know. So, about the agent here, I want to show you just code, and then I have two more slides or something that is super interesting. So here actually is snippet code that I found online that I use personally in my code that I want to share with you. I don't know if you throttle agent. It's just an agent that control how many computation can run simultaneously. What it does here, it waiting in this loop here. Actually, let's say it starts in the working state, okay? So it start at this point, waiting asynchronously for this message. Receive my message, it's gonna check what kind of message it can be completed or work. If it's work, I'm gonna spawn my work asynchronously, okay? Until my limit that I declare here when I set my new agent here is reached. Can be two, can be one, can be many. When I reach my limit, it's going to change the state to waiting. It's going to go here, and that's the scan part. Actually, the message won't be lost, won't be buffered, but it won't be computation. As soon as I see the complete from my work here, when my work complete, they're going to send back to the same agent the complete. If I reach and I'm under my limit, I'm going to reach and stay my working. I'm going to start to recompute the first message in a queue. So that's something pretty cool.
The scan stay at the end, scan stays at the front of the queue, always just processing items as they come in, but it doesn't take them off.
Right. Yeah, until you change state.
It doesn't the scan. Every time, it's just as a new one comes in.
Right.
Okay, that's cool.
Another one pretty cool is the bug agent. So this is, I have a demo in the code that I'm not going to show, but you can download it and build it, I mean, and play with. What it does here, again, this is a FS snip online, so if I find the snip there. This is pretty cool because you can create your instance, the agent, and declare the quantity of message you want to compute at the time or the timeout. Let's say you create, I want to deal with 10 messages in 10 seconds. If you have, you know, received 10 messages, you're going to start to compute this 10 message. Or if you have like few messages but the timeout expire, you're going to compute the message that you have in the queue. And that's pretty cool. And it's all be here is, I'm not going to go in detail, but again, it's pretty cool. Actually, as you can see here, I decorated this with the CLI event because I can make C sharp use and leverage this kind of and parallel work agent here, we went there too. The blocking queue is something I'm going to part to my final demo, my grand finale. So what it does here is just a trade save collection. But, well, before I go to the code, let's go actually to quick to the last two slides here and to the so part of the actor model is very cool, and you can leverage, you know, the actor model in your current programming. And one pattern that I really found very useful, in my opinion, in my work, is the pipeline pattern. So the idea is very simple. So you have a few agents that wait for message to compute. Each computation isolated from the other computation in continuous. So, for instance, my demo is that I have the first agent that is just a synchronous load images, and then when the images are loaded, you're gonna pass to the second agent, that's the second stage of my pipeline, and then get the image and process, maybe resize it, change the color, and when it's done, it's passed to my second stage, but at the same time, maybe receive another image. And so it really asynchronous, and in parallel, if you're a multi-core machine, you can run this in a distributed system, and it just reach very high performance. So this is pretty much the code that's gonna be in my last demo, but you're gonna go through the code or the blocking agent there in top. And then I create a computation. This is a block for each stage of my pipeline. They do something. And when it's done, as you can see, each state get a message asynchronously. And when I receive it, perform some process, and then push it back to the second stage. So it's a pipeline, right? So let's go to the final demo. And do you have the ticket for the raffle?
Yeah.
Well, maybe, well, Brian, can you pass the ticket around?
Yeah, sure. Thanks.
So this is a blocking queue agent. What there is a queue part of the body of my agent here. And what it does is different kind of state. In my agent, right? We have the empty queue, no empty queue, and change the state according with the size, with the number of elements that there are inside my queue. So I can set the max size of my collection in my agent. So the first stage, of course, my queue is empty. So it's run here as an empty state. And this is the state. What it does, well, the only thing it can do in an empty queue is waiting for something, right? So it's waiting asynchronously for a message to arrive, and I'm gonna fill the queue, and of course the queue is not empty anymore, so I'm gonna change the state, and we have more get and more add, sorry, and we're gonna increase the queue, or we can get from the queue, right? And if the queue become empty, again, here, I can change the state to the queue again. So this is important in a pipeline platter because the second stage of the pipeline is getting from the first stage of the pipeline, the first queue, and could start to fill the own queue. And the agent starts to process each element at a time. So I hope this is the.
But if you want, each agent has its own queue.
Right.
Which agent is
this? But if you want to have one queue and multiple agents, like first stage, five agents, second stage.
Yeah, you can do that. You can do that. Actually, even better that I saw in some distributed system, really they can have agent that control the work what we know, and automatically say this pipeline got a little bottleneck, so I'm gonna add a new agent there. So. Pipeline agent here. Okay. Oh, wait. This is all the code, but pretty much what we're looking for here. Okay, this is the blocking agent without comment. Pipeline agent. So here, this is the computation that each stage of the pipeline is responsible, right? So you have the load image, I'm gonna add some scale here, I'm gonna put some noise in images, and then I'm gonna render my image, okay? So here what I do, I'm gonna create a blocking queue agent, for each of my stage. So each stage, you're gonna, the first stage, you're gonna just get my image and pass to my first blocking queue. The second stage of my pipeline, you're gonna grab the message, do something with, and send it to the third stage. And then you're gonna repeat to the stage and so on. And when I'm in the hand, I'm gonna just run all my stages synchronously. That's all I have to do, right? So, all right. This is my dog. As you can see here, I have my loading stage here, resizing filter, and idea with 113 millisecond for image to go through all the pipeline. I think this the pipeline is one of the things that it really can be useful also in a current, you know, you can apply in your job.
I was wondering how this looks in Task Manager.
Let's figure out.
Because yeah, it's
and I think that I didn't go through deeply in the demo because one of the demo will actually compare in this way, and then when I use a parallel task, when I go through and manipulate the pixel for the image, they actually do sequential here, but as you can see, it's quite intense.
Wow. Well, I gotta ask maybe an elementary question because you're here. You talked obviously processes, threads, and it's been a while since I've thought about handles.
Mm-hmm.
Where do they come in? Is threads have got a number of handles? Is that
yeah,
what
you see here, we have right now there we have 1,042 threads running in all my machine, right?
Sure.
And there are 31,000 handles. So The thread actually come from the thread pool, right? So it's all handled behind the scene for you. This is managed core, so that's the beauty. Mm. So you don't have to deal with this stuff anymore. That's why we love .NET so much, right? Which is a double-edged sword, I guess, right? It's nice, but can have also something.
So can we see the process? Because I'm curious. Clearly, most of the CPU is working on your calculation here.
Right. Right now is 64, 69, 75, 80. It depends also, maybe sometimes there are more time spent in the first stage, try to fill up the second, the third stage, and when you arrive to the third stage, that actually deal with the image manipulation, you're gonna have...
Is this an endless loop or running?
Yes, yeah, okay. Endless loop. So the pipeline. That's it. So my goal for tonight, just hopefully give you some more familiar with the synchronous, you know, programming. See how cool is F sharp, make your life easier,
yeah.
And program also fun.
Amazing.
GitHub.
Wow.
My code. I didn't post it, but I'm gonna post it, I promise. I'm pretty good at this stuff. Good. Twitter, my email there, and by the way, I'm Riccardo, doesn't know me, but. All right, that's all I got, so